Hello, VC. Today I thought it'd be a little bit of self-indulgence. I'm going to show some of my favorite bands from the 60s and 70s. So these would have been bands or artists that I tried to collect most of the music that I could find, as opposed to just picking up an odd album here and there by other artists. And so let's just get started right into it. Some of my favorites. And we'll start off with Deep Purple.
In ages past, when spells were cast, in a time of men and steel, where a man was taught no special thing, it was all done by feel.
So when it comes to Deep Purple, I have quite a few of their albums, certainly not all of them, but my favorite are their earlier stuff. I tend to like their first five or six albums, especially the first two or three, because their early stuff tends to be a little bit psychedelic, as opposed to later stuff like Smoke on the Water, which is still a great album, of course. One thing I'm going to mention too. So I'm going to show maybe eight or nine albums from my favorite bands from the 60s and 70s. And there is a common thread with these albums. There's something that they have in common. See if you can guess what it is. The second band that I was collecting was 10 Years After.
Woman trouble always in my life. Got a baby, but you'll never be my wife. Cause I know, baby. Yes, I know. When she got you, man, you'll never let him go. You see her in the street with a sparkling eye. Don't forget that she knows how to cry. Cause I know. Yes, I know. When she got you, man, you'll never let me go.
So I think I have all their studio albums. I'm not absolutely sure, but I think I do. And of all of them, this was the hardest one to find. It took quite a while to find that album. Another band that I really like, and I liked them from the very first time I ever heard them when I was a kid, and that was CCR. So once again, as far as I know, I do have all their studio albums. They're on the Fantasy label. So just to let you know, Deep Purple album that I showed was 1968, 10 years after, and this CCR is 1969. Here's one that's perhaps not quite as well known as some of these other bands and artists I'm showing. Maybe not quite as high profile, but it's an artist I certainly like. And this is Harvey Mandel. once again, I think I have all his studio albums, but you can never be really sure. There might be something obscure that you're missing. Here's a band that is probably my first sort of like rock band that I liked. And I liked them, well, I guess it was around 13 years old. And how I come to know about this band and a few others at the time was that my uncle left his 8-track system at my parents' house. And so I was playing all his 8-tracks. And my favorite 8-track was this album here, Santana.
Got a black magic woman. Got a black magic woman. I've got a black magic woman. Got me so blind I can't see. That she's a black magic woman. She's trying to make a devil out of me. Turn your back on me, baby. Don't turn your back on me, baby. Yes, don't turn your back on me, baby. Stop messing around with me.
So Santana's put out quite a few albums, and I certainly don't have all of them or even near all of them, but I have quite a few Santana albums, but I have to say their first three albums have always been my favorite. After that, nothing else came close, really. Here's an album that our band I discovered when the radio station I was listening to at the time played them, and when I first heard them I went, what the heck is that? That sounds amazing. And the band is Hawkwind. Hawkwind was on the United Artists label. The very first thing I ever heard from Hawkwind was a cut from Warrior on Edge of Time, which just absolutely blew me away. So I went out and bought that album, and then I started hunting down all their other albums. Now again with Hawkwind, I would say like their first five albums are my favorite. They've been putting out albums for years, but after about five albums, I guess due to personnel changes, like Lemmy was gone, Nick Turner was gone, I just didn't quite like the music as much. I did continue buying some of their albums, but the first five were the five that I really, really like. And it was nice to have the space log here in this one. Here's an artist whose sort of vocal styles really caught my attention. And always a big fan of his. I was buying his records even when I was young and started buying records, could afford to buy records. And this is J.J. Cale.
You told me this, you told me that, you tried to tell me where it was at. You said you loved me, I can't see through that. Lies, lies, lies. You left me hanging, hanging from the limb. You said you loved me, then you left with him. Lord, you did it to me, I see.
So I'm missing a few of his studio albums. There's a couple there that are a little bit hard to get. I never came across them in the wild, and they're even hard to get online. But a huge J.J. Cale fan. Should mention the J.J. Cale record came out in 1972. That Hawkwind album came out in, I think that was also 1971. And here's another group. I'll tell you an interesting story about this, but this is Roxy Music. So of course that was a modern reissue of the album. The Roxy Music is one of the first bands I saw when the vinyl resurgence was just starting, and my local record store at the time was almost still all CDs. And here I walk in one day, and Roxy Music's first four albums are now in vinyl format again, up on the wall, $15 each. And my first thought was, geez, why they got vinyl in? Everybody's CD. And I eventually came around to buying them, and glad I did. There were excellent pressings. So that one thing too is, I heard of Brian Ferry before I heard Roxy Music. On the radio station, they were playing Brian Ferry's Hard Rain's Gonna Fall. So I rushed down to the big record store downtown and went in there, obviously, went to section F looking for Brian Ferry. Couldn't find anything. So I went to a girl that worked at the store. She was around 18 years old, and I said, I'm looking for Brian Ferry records. And she said, who? I said, Brian Ferry. I'm looking for Brian Ferry. And she goes, who? And at that point, a guy walks up. He's wearing platform shoes, leather pants, leather vests, a top hat, walking cane in his ear, and oversized sunglasses. And he just said, as he's walking by, Brian Ferry's up on the second floor in the Roxy Music section. And I just watched him walk by. And the girl said, dude, did you see that? And I just took off upstairs, found Roxy Music, looked in the bin, and there's the Brian Ferry album. And I'm thinking to myself, why in the heck are they filing Brian Ferry under R, Roxy Music? God, couldn't figure that out. And of course, back then, I was very young back then, and didn't stop to have a look at the credits on the back of the Roxy Music albums. Would have answered my question. So anyway, that Roxy Music came out in 1973. Here's another band that I'm a big fan of. And again, to the best of my knowledge, I do have all their studio albums. I have a few live albums too, and I think one or two might be bootlegs. But this is Talking Heads. So I've heard that movie they did, Stop Making Sense, is being re-released this summer. I think it's the 40th year anniversary or something. I had that on DVD. I had it on VHS as well. So that Roxy Music album came out in 1973. Another band I was really big on, and that is Japan. Love's incentives on the stuff. Regular frauds come blind. Still afraid of everyone. Love is unsatisfied. The radio station I listened to at the time really played a lot of Japan. Every album that came out, they played it quite a bit. And when Tin Drum came out that particular year, the listeners voted that the number one album of the year, which caught the DJs by a bit surprised. But all of the Japan stuff I really liked. And I think that came out in 1978. So the final album I'll show. So here, this was an artist who I was aware of when her records were coming out, or the band records were coming out. But I wasn't until the flea market days that I started sort of buying them, rediscovering the music and fantastic music. And that is Susie and the Banshees. This is a Japanese pressing, and again, to the best of my knowledge, I think I have all of Susie and the Banshees studio albums on vinyl. A couple of them I could not get within a North American source. I couldn't get on Amazon or whatever. A couple of her latest albums, I had to get them from Europe, and they came from Spain. Same thing with B-52s. When I was collecting B-52s, a couple of their very latest albums, I could not get vinyl format for from a North American source. I had to go to Europe. Mind you, that was years ago, so that may have all changed. The stuff could all be up on Amazon now, as far as I know. One thing I just, did anyone notice when I was showing them to Japan, the Braille sticker here? That was one day when I went to the flea market, of course, a number of years ago, and they must have had a collection of records from someone who was blind, because all the records had the Braille stickers on them. And I did buy a number of them. On a few of them, I was able to remove the Braille. On others, it's on there pretty good, and so I didn't want to risk damaging the jacket. So that's it for today. Those are some of my favorite bands that were around in the 60s and 70s, who I'm trying to collect all their music. And once again, there is a common thread with all these records that I showed. And perhaps you can figure out what it was. As always, thank you for watching. Have a great day. And just one quick note. I'm doing some home renovations, so I'm going to be offline now for the next couple of weeks. I got just the one computer, a desktop computer. It has to be disassembled because there's going to be a lot of work done in this room and other rooms. So I'll see you guys again probably in a couple of weeks. Take care.